It aims to build 100 chapters in different cities by 2022. It will soon open its membership for institutions and individuals. It also imparts training for leaders, teachers, students, and
अरे
parents. So as you know that so far we have conducted 142 sessions successfully. We have received 17,459 registrations, 16,272 questions on national education policy. We have seen participation from 7 countries: India, USA, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Nepal, Kuwait, and Russia. From India, we have seen participation from 22 states and 119 cities. We aim to organize minimum 200 sessions. With this, we would be reaching out to 100,000 educators, 20,000 institutions, and 1,000 plus eminent speakers, like today's speakers, would be joining us to share their perspective and thoughts on national education policy. Now, I would request you all to join me in welcoming our key speakers for this very special 143rd session. Our first key speaker, our very senior education leader, Dr. Pradeep Kumar. Pradeep sir is the Pro Vice Chancellor with Manav Vichra International University, Faridabad, Haryana. Professor Dr. Pradeep Kumar has 30 years of teaching and research experience. He did his BSc Honours Physics from Delhi University, MSc from Jamia Millia Islamia, and PhD from National Physics Laboratory. He was awarded Research Associate Fellowship by CSIR and Research Associate Fellowship by DRDO. He has authored 6 books and published 29 research papers in national and international journals and in the proceedings of international and national conferences. Professor Kumar is a life member of Indian Physics Association and Meteorology Society of India. He has major contributions in several major research projects at Jamia Millia Islamia University. His administrative experience include at Pro VC Galgotia University, Greater Noida. Professor Kumar is an educationist, visionary leader, campaigner with impact for social causes for more than 30 years of experience in teaching. OBE expert conducting academic and applied research, licensed with academic bodies, expertise in corporate affairs, experience in collaboration with international universities. Big thanks, Pradeep sir, for joining. It's an honor to have you.
Thank you, Rajab.
Welcome.
Thank you, Rajab. Yeah. Yes.
Next speaker, Munish Kumar Srivastava ji. Munish sir is principal with the St. Lamart Senior Secondary School, Udham Singh Nagar, Uttarakhand. He's an accomplished education management leader with proven track record in leading pace setting all the day-to-day affairs of schools across the country and abroad schools under CBSE, Ministry of HRD and ICSE Education Board. Recognized for a strong commitment to maintaining quality standards that meet institutional objectives by relying on a unique combination of intuitive management skills and leadership qualities of 21st century leaders, mainly focusing upon 4 C's: communication, creativity, collaboration, and critical thinking. He has worked with many prestigious schools like KLM International School, Pathankot, Punjab, Dream India School, Balia, Uttar Pradesh, Asian International School, Abu Dhabi, UAE, Indian Embassy School, Yemen. He has been a CBSE Center Chief for the session 2014-15 at Asian International Private School, Abu Dhabi, UAE. He has also been the central superintendent CBSE for consecutive 2 sessions for board examinations for grade 10th and 12th in Indian Embassy School of Republic of Yemen. Munish sir would be joining us in the next 10 to 15 minutes. Our next speaker, another very senior education leader, SK Singh sir. Singh sir is principal with Bharatiya Vidyapeeth Senior Secondary School, Agra, Uttar Pradesh. He is having experience of over 32 years in the field of education and 21 years as principal. He has done BSc, MSc, MPhil, MC, and B.Ed. He has worked with many prestigious schools like BRGD Residential School, Churu, Rajasthan, Army Public School, Agra, Kent, Army School, Sri Ganganagar, Rajasthan, St. Andrews Senior Secondary School, Agra. He has attended several in-service teachers training programs. He has also worked as a CBSE mentor for CCE, attended CBSE Meet on experiential learning. He has also been the master trainer with Intel for training teachers. He has been recognized and awarded for his contribution to the field of education many times. We welcome you, SK Singh sir. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you.
Hi, everybody. Hi.
Thank you, sir, for joining. Welcome. I'll come back to you.
Okay.
Uh, Pradeep Chahal sir won't be able to join us due to some health emergencies. Our next speaker, a very senior EdTech leader, Jaswinder Singh Ji. Jaswinder Ji is founder and CEO of Wordsworth ELT. Jaswinder Singh Ji has an experience of 30 years in the field of education and technology and has also served as a consultant to UNESCO on education. Wordsworth English Lab is designed for India and is highly research initiative of the ACT UNIF Group, a trusted education company with 2 decades of service in technology, education and training. Its expertise in technology, multimedia and content development has been instrumental in presenting a world-class language lab solution for academia in India. In a short span of time, Wordsworth English Language Lab has managed considerable recognition across the country for its unique content and methodology. Over 3,000 installations in institutions across the country stand testimony of the quality in product, implementation, training, and continual service provided by the ACT UNIF and its committed network of leaders.
So we welcome their Android mobile application.
Thank you, Raji. Thank you.
So big thanks once again to all the key speakers for joining. With this, now we come to the next part of the session, which is the opening remark part. I would be requesting all our key speakers if we can have your quick 1 minute opening remark. So I would request Pradeep sir, sir, if we can have your 1 minute opening remark.
Okay, thank you everyone. The education and skilling are taking a new concept these days, and it has been talked at almost every forum. And the new education policy is very clear now, and it will be totally student-centric. If you see the features of new education policy, especially when if I talk about the higher education system, now all university institutions will be working very hard. The reason is now they have given the full freedom to student as choice-based credit system. And under that choice-based credit system, if I have taken, for example, in any degrees of 120 credits, so if I have taken, say, 20 credits from University X, then I'm free to take rest of my credits from University Y and University Z, and nobody can stop that. This is very, very important point. So as a university or as an educational institution, especially in higher studies, we have to deliver. We have to come with some outcome-based education. Earlier, people were giving only degrees. Now they need to see the degree is multidisciplinary. The degree is choice-based credit system. The degree has a component of skilling and employability. The degree has a component of startup and entrepreneurship. Only then the degree will be awarded. And I'm free. There is no boundary between science, commerce, and arts. As a student of science, I can have one course in management, one course in psychology, one course in design. Yes, what I need to have, I need to complete my total number of credits, that is 120 credits. So this is the new beginning, but it has a lot of challenges also. Challenge in the sense, in the education system, we need to see how a student will be able to earn these programs. There may be some clashes. There may be the scarcity of faculty available. And there will be many challenges. But if somehow, slowly and slowly, we tackle all these challenges, then it's coming out to a very wonderful output. So end of the day, if my course outcome, my program outcomes are not defined, are not as per the requirement of employer, as per the requirement of the student, as per the requirement of other stakeholders, then the question will be definitely asked by the student, why I'm going for this degree. And the other biggest challenge which is coming out to be, which we have learned last 1 year especially, that is the online education. I may be a good brand as an educational institution, but if my faculty and my delivery is not as per the material available online, other certification courses, then student will ask question. Because they have now sources, they can compare, they will see the result output, and the employers will have no question. They will not be asking any question whether you have got the degree from X or Y university. They will see what you have learned, what is the output of what you can deliver. So definitely it is coming out to be very, very big challenge for the institutions. And
absolutely. Parents. Thank you. You touched upon a few very important areas, be it choice-based credit system and the challenges which is coming along with this online technology integration. I would be coming back to you for a detailed perspective. Now, with this, I would invite Sandeep sir. Sir, if you can have your quick opening remark.
Hello, everybody. First of all, my compliments, my congrats to one and all for hosting such a nice webinar in the leadership talks on execution of NEP by the Indian and International Educational Council. Yes, it's the law of nature that old order changes, yielding place for the new one. Now, it's a physical law, it's a law of nature, and we have seen that in place for the old system of 10 plus 2 structure of school curriculum, now this system has been replaced by a 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 curriculum structure corresponding to the age groups of 3 to 8, 8 to 11, 11 to 14, and 14 to 18 years respectively. Now, positively, this new system will have in 12 years of schooling and 3 years of Anganwadi or preschooling. That is the new education policy. Now, we'll be discussing this in detail, and I think it's a positive step. So once again, my hello to all, and looking forward for a healthy and a fruitful discussion. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Singh sir. And now I would invite Jaswinder sir. And meanwhile, I must recognize the presence of Dr. Shubhi Prasad, ma'am, our principal, Sunflower Public School, Agra, Uttar Pradesh. Welcome, Shubhi, ma'am. Thank you for joining.
Yeah.
So, sir, if you can have your opening remarks.
Yeah. Thank you, Rajulji, and good afternoon to everybody. I will start. See, I come from the edtech industry, and the way Pradeep Kumar, sir, talked about technology. Sir, I would want to second you on this point is that this new education policy and the new era that we would call as a post-COVID era, a lot is going to depend on technology. Because the online learning, it even if it doesn't come in full, but there's going to be blended learning and blended teaching that is going to work. That also means that a student in any part of our country can access content from any part of the world. So each and every institution will have to be at its best, point one. So this will definitely improve the quality of education in our country. But not only that, you may have the best of teachers with you, you may have the best of curriculum, but you will have to invest into technology to make that curriculum available online. Let me tell you what a lot of companies have done is they have, during the pandemic, when they were not having students, they were not having customers, they were not doing, they were all investing into becoming technically strong enough to cater to the new requirements, which are going to be there in the post-COVID era. So in my main talk, I'm going to talk about how could technology be used in the simplest of manner without investing much into it to the benefit of teaching learning. And second is I come from the language background. We are an edtech company dealing with languages. We work with some 3,000 schools in the country and cater to more than a million students every day. So how is it that the new policy, which talks about using mother tongue as teaching, for teaching during the foundation years or even up to class 5 or class 8, what change will it bring? What needs to be done? How do we cater to these requirements and still keep working with English as a language? So that's what I'm going to focus on. And I look forward to a very fruitful session today. Thank you.
Thank you, Jaswinder sir. We all are very excited to hear your ideas in detail. I'll come back to you. Now, with this, we come to the next part of the session, which is the main talk session. I would be inviting our key speakers once again for their detailed perspective. But before I invite our first key speaker, I just would like to share the learnings which we have had during our last 142 sessions. During our last 142 sessions, as I said in the beginning, almost all the participants shared that this is a wonderful document. This document has the potential to change the face of Indian education. But almost same number of participants shared that this document is such an ambitious document, it is going to be very difficult in terms of execution. Many people cited the example of CCE, that it was also a wonderful initiative but got failed due to poor execution. Many educators who participated share that teachers training is an area of concern. Many believe, yes, teachers training is going to be area of concern, but the bigger area of concern, lack of intent among teachers to get trained. Lot of people said that finance is going to be a key concern area. Many people believe that this pandemic has exposed how poor infrastructure we have, poorly distribution we have for the digital infrastructure. That is going to be another area of challenge. Lot of people who participated believe that, good schools in urban areas already implementing many of these ideas. So biggest challenge would be for budget schools, government school and rural school. So I would request all our key speakers that while sharing our perspective, if you can also suggest some idea or some best practice which you have been implementing in your respective institution. So that would make this session more engaging, more useful for all of us. So with this thought, I would invite our first key speaker, Professor Dr. Pradeep Kumar sir. Pradeep sir, over to you.
Okay, thank you, Ranjal, being the first speaker. My initial comments and change very fast, and there'll be challenges and confusion also, a lot of confusion also. So as I was listening to other speaker, the biggest problem which is coming, which will be, what are you teaching in the class, whether you have quoted the references or you taken help from any book or any source available, nobody was there to check you. But the moment you upload the material in the public domain and the material is not created by you or you have not taken the permission, then there'll be challenges. So what I can see with the new education policy, and when we are supposed to upload the material on the portal, there will be many cases of litigations. So as an advocate, it's a good sign. Number of cases will be there. And lot of criticism also. Then students will compare and they will see the originality of the faculty. So as a faculty, we need to have excellent faculty members, good in fundamentals, those who have even contributed to research, innovative, not only in the delivery, but also in critical thinking. So there I'm finding problem. Because as of now, I'm sorry to say, but the teaching is the last priority. So even if I'm pursuing UG, PG program, professional courses, etc., very few people, they opt teaching as the first priority. And all the other channels are exhausted, then they go for the teaching. So the new course they have added in the new education policy, that is integrated B.Ed. program. Instead of 1 year B.Ed., now it will be 4 year B.Ed. program. So we need to see how many students would like to go for this 4 year integrated B.Ed. program. Because after the graduation is completed, then only most of the students take a call whether they want to go for education and to go for the B.Ed. program. Now, a student who has just passed 12th class, only 17 years old, at that stage, as a student and as a parent, I have to take a call that I want to be a teacher. It is very difficult. I believe very few parents and students will decide for this integrated four-year program. Then from where we'll get faculty members? And if I'm not getting quality faculty members, then whatever we're talking about, the new education policy, the outcome-based education, and the multidisciplinary concept, critical thinking, innovation, I don't think these will be realized. So that is again a challenge. Similarly, I may be good teacher in the class, but when I'm recording my lecture or preparing my content, I may or may not be. So as a faculty, I'm good. As a subject, as a fundamental of the subject, I'm good. But for delivery point of view, the presentation point of view, I may or may not be. And the designing of the designing of the PPTs and designing of the material and putting on the online, that is another art. So how I am good in technology also, how I'm using my technology, the latest tools available, that is again question. And who will be training? Faculty members are already there. So who will be training those faculty members? Most of us use laptop only for typing purpose. And if we need to create those kind of laptops only, then the cost will be hardly 25%. Because we are not using, similarly the mobile and other facilities. So tools will be there, but who will train them? That will be another question. So it will take some time. I don't think the outcome of new education policy or the skilling and the other parameters which are framed and which are talking about and expecting, we'll be able to see the light of all these in coming 3, 4, 5. I think minimum 1 decade or 2 decades are required if we need to see the real outcome of these initiatives. But yes, we need to begin from scratch. We need to take first step first. So if you take first step first, maybe after 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, slowly, slowly we'll reach up to 10%, 15%, 20%, 30%. And this is the right time to take this step. Otherwise, all school buildings, college buildings, university buildings, infrastructure will all go waste. We should learn from the Western universities. The universities in the US, the university in Australia, university in the UK, they are asking students from the Asian countries. And more than 60% students are only from India and China. But with the new system which you have learned in last 1 year, why do we require this infrastructure? We don't require. If everything is available, the best practices, the best teaching, the best tools are available online, then why do we need? Rather, I'm expecting the next 5 years or 10 years, there will be online universities. And the biggest taker will be the online universities, especially the courses where you don't require practicals. Now the virtual labs are also there. In engineering also, we have many labs which are now available virtual. I know that some components will be missing, the group activity and how we interact. And there are many things beyond the lecture room. Those things will be missing, but especially in the higher education, the PG level, or in some specialized courses, we don't require any infrastructure now. So as an institution, as a leader, as an educationist, we have to put more money on the technology and not on creating the infrastructure. The virtual platform, the virtual labs, these need to be strengthened. We need to invest a lot of money and train our faculty members, see the record, how the outcome is there, and take confidence of the industry people, the employers, and other stakeholders. Thank you.
Thank you, Pradeep sir, for this this wonderful and very powerful talk and your suggestions. You began by highlighting the importance of this choice-based credit system and how it is going to create the most desired impact. You also talked about that this NEP would eventually create a need for original content, and that is going to bring a lot of changes in the process. You also talked about that 4-year integrated BEd program and the kind of challenges it may face. And then you emphasized upon the importance of training, that this is going to be key. And you have your assessment that results of this NEP would be visible in next 8-10 years. So we need to stay focused till that time. And then, you also said like this is the right time to introduce these big changes. And in the end, you called upon all of us, all the educators, that we need to invest our energy, our resources more on technology rather than on infrastructure. And training again is going to be key. So big thanks, Pradeep sir, for sharing these important and valuable points. I would come back to you with questions. And now I would invite Sandeep sir, sir, if you can have your perspective in details. Sandeep Kumar Singh, sir.
Hello, everybody. Good evening. The new education policy, the NEP 2020, it replaces the National Policy of Education of 1986 after about 34 years, for which ministry undertook a rigorous consultation process in formulating a draft. Over 2 lakh suggestions, 2.5 lakh gram panchayats, 6,600 blocks, and about 6,000 urban local bodies, they work together, about 676 districts. Suggestions were received from all those, and thereafter NEP was planned. Now, firstly, I would like to focus on the 10 key points of the NEPs. Firstly, it emphasizes on schooling from the age of 3 years, in which the new system will have 12 years of schooling with 3 years of Anganwadi or preschoolings. Secondly, the system will be of 5+3+3+4 educational structure. The new system will cover 4 stages. The foundation stage, in which 3 years of Anganwadi and preschools, followed by classes 1 and 2. Preparatory stage, classes 3 to 5. Middle stage, classes 6, 7, 8. And the secondary stage from classes 9 to 12. Thirdly, there will be a no rigid separation between science, arts, and the commerce streams. Now, if we could recollect, in this present system, after class 10th, the student selects whether to go for the science stream, arts stream, or a commerce stream. And thereafter, he or she decides its future. But in this, there will be no rigid separations or as such. The student can opt subject across the streams, and all subjects will be offered at 2 levels of proficiency. The fourth point in this is that the internship and vocational education from class 6 onward. Vocational education will start in schools from the 6th grade and will include informal internships. The fifth point, the board exam will be at the lowest stakes. Board exams are aimed to encourage holistic development and to test for the capacities and competencies. Student will be allowed to take board exam on up to 2 occasions during any given school. 1 main examination and 1 for improvement. If desired, student will take school examinations in classes 3, 5, 8, which will be conducted in by the appropriate authorities. Sixth point at this stage is that a new policy introduces undergraduate degrees of either 3 or 4 years duration. Midterm dropouts will be given the credits and options to complete degree after a break. The seventh point, key point, is that 50% gross enrollment ratio by 2035. Major reforms in higher education includes a target of 50% gross enrollment ratio, that is GER, by 2035, and provision of multiple entry and exits. The eighth key point in this stage is that National Testing Agency, that is NTA, to conduct common college entrance exam twice a year. The ninth key point in this stage is cap of college fees. That is, fees will be fixed within the regulatory framework and no extra fees will be charged beyond that particular cap. And the last point, the 10th one, MPhil to be discontinued. MPhil courses will be discontinued under the new policy, and all courses at UG, PG and PhD level will be interdisciplinary. Now, I should move forward and say that the early childhood care and education, that is ECCE, is more than a preparation for the primary school, and it aims at the holistic development of the child's social, emotional and cognitive, and also the physical need in order to build a solid and good foundation for lifelong learning and well-being. Early childhood care and education stands as a prelude to the entire development of the child's future. ECCE aims at the total development of the child's physical, motor, emotional, social, cognitive, language, and morale. Learning begins at birth. All children are born with the capacity to learn, the most solid base on which any society can build. Of more than 800 million 0 to 6 years old children in the world, less than the third benefit from the early childhood education programs. The challenge is enormous because of the demographic pressures and increased poverty and most countries' experiences. Yet, efficient and low-cost option for early childhood exists and all adapted to the needs of the children. The life conditions of the families, the culture, and the resource of the countries. Their implementations depend more on creating adequate political and social will than on the other factors. Moving ahead, literacy and numeracy are also important because they form the basis of our learning. They are required to learn other skills as well as the participation in everyday life. Literacy and numeracy skills underpins workforce participation, productivity, and the broader economy, and can also impact on social and health outcomes. Numeracy is the knowledge, skills, behavior, and dispositions that students need in order to use mathematics in a wide range of situations. It involves recognizing and understanding the role of mathematics in the world and having a dispositions and capacities to use mathematical knowledge and skill purposefully. Some implications for that: evidence-based practices to improve literacy and numeracy. Intervene early and maintain the focus. Know what student can do and target teaching accordingly. Have clear and transparent learning goals. Focus on teachers professionally learning and to improve the teaching of literacy and numeracy. Now, some holistic approach that encourages children to make connection in a subject using their creative skill, develop psychological, social, and emotional growth, make learning natural, and engaging, make learning fun and meaningful experiences. To develop the information skill, learning and innovation skill, communication skills, life and career skills of all learners. In the basic education program, the five major approaches are constructivistic, collaborative, integrative, reflective, and inquiry-based learning. Next, I must say that 21st century teaching means teaching as you have always taught, but with today's tool and technology, it means utilizing everything that is important in today's world so that students will be able to live and prosper in today's economy, as well as having the ability to guide students and to prepare them for the future. Now, challenges before us: lack of time for planning, lot of paperwork, performance pressure from the school administrators, balancing diversity learning needs, handle too many masters, get burned out easily, lack of proper funding, and limitation of standardized testing. Now, every learner matters in culture and equality of the education, in which all children and young people should learn together wherever possible, regardless of any difficulty or differences they may have. Inculcate schools and learning setting and must recognize and respond to the diverse need of their student. Equality. This module is intended for any teacher, educator, or staff members who seek to ensure that all students, regardless of background and personal circumstances, have opportunity to reach their full potential. Now, I should summarize the things over here, and I should share my experience in my school. Now, long time back, when we used to have, suppose, the practicals and all, the system that we used to follow then, and if we compare that system of today's methodological, we find that long time back we used to fill in that those practical marks with the pen. We used to retain one carbon copy, we used to send the copy with the by the post, and various other methods. But now the system has changed, and we fill in all these marks and all online, and for that we are utilizing a technology. Similarly, if we look into the other competitive examinations also, the things, they have been completely changed now. And this is the main focus of the NEP, that in this NEP, the technology will be used more as compared to other aspects. So as sir has also rightly said, that we may have a nice infrastructure, we may emphasize on a nice infrastructure, but the technology part is very, very important in this NEP. And the clear-cut example of technology was reflected during the pandemic time. Now, during the pandemic time, what we observed was that our teaching staff and various other faculty, though they were not having the knowledge of technology, but they struggled hard and they were successful in taking the online classes. And the teachers and the other staff, they were not given the training of that also. Nobody was given the training, and they successfully cleared about a year, and they have taken the online classes over there. And we found that the children also, they were satisfied And one of the session has already been completed in most of the schools also. So this was a clear cut example, and NEP focuses on the same thing, that technology should be there, otherwise nothing will be possible in the schools. So thank you very much, and I hand over the mic to
thank you, big thanks Sandeep sir. You touched upon all the important parts of NEP and how those things are going to change Indian education in general, and I would say India in general, Indian education in particular. You summarized all the important initiatives in NEP in 10 key points, and you explain all those 10 key points to us. You began by emphasizing the importance of foundational stage according to the new proposed NEP, and then you also talked about this NEP is not offering any hard separation between science and art subjects and curricular and co-curricular activities. You also talked about that this NEP is going to empower our students to, to be more flexible in terms of choosing subjects. You also talked about the importance of vocational education and how it is going to change, bring that much desired impact. You also shared your assessment that board exams are going to have lower stakes after this NEP implementation. So, this would give more space to students to explore other ideas, other areas. And then you also touched upon, you explained the target by government for the 50% GER by 2035. Though many experts believe it is too ambitious, but it's again a very good target. And we all must work towards to, achieve this. Then you also talked about this NEP is proposing interdisciplinary courses in higher education. That is again another way of empowering our learners in order to create more, employable graduates. Then you also again talked about the importance of ECCE, and as per the National Education Policy, NEP aims for this ECCE. It is preparing young learners for the primary education, and also for their lifelong learning and well-being. You also talked about those evidence-based practices, then eventually talked about the importance and why we should inculcate 21st century skills among our learners. You explained those skills for all of us, and then you explained what do we mean by 21st century teaching, and why all the teachers need to get trained to become 21st century teachers. And, a lot of people, a lot of experts who have participated, they have shared that today's teachers are not the only source of information for learners or students. Today, when a student comes to teacher, he is not coming to teacher for the information. They are far, far bigger sources of information than a teacher for a today's student. When a student comes to teacher today, he is coming for the perspective. So teachers need to become facilitators rather than instructors. So big thanks, Sandeep sir, for sharing and these important points. I'll come back to you with questions. Thank you, sir. And meanwhile, we have been joined by Dr. Anju Mehrotra ji, Anju ma'am from Kalka Group of Educational Institutions. Welcome, Anju ma'am. Big thanks for joining. Your regular participation is a big motivation for all of us. और हम जसविंदर सर को इसी हम बुला पाते हैं कि भी आज अंजू मैम आने वाले हैं, आप प्लीज आइए. सो जसविंदर सर, इज
आई हैव जस्ट स्पोक टू अंजू मैम यस्टरडे, सो थैंक यू अगेन. थैंक यू.
ग्रेट. थैंक यू. एंड वी हैव बीन जॉइंड बाय मुनीश कुमार श्रीवास्तव सर. वेलकम मुनीश सर, थैंक यू फॉर जॉइनिंग सर. We are in the third part of the session. We started with the introduction, then we took the opening remark from all the participants, and then this is the main talk part which is going on. So I would request, before I go to Jasvinder sir, Munish sir, if I can take your opening remark, if you can, you want to share something for, let's say, as an opening remark for 1 minute. I'll come back to you after Jasvinder sir for a detailed perspective, but if you can, you want to share something as an opening remark, Munish sir. Sir, you are on mute. Munish sir, you are on mute.
He is not on mute. His audio is not okay.
Munish, there is a problem in your audio. So I would request if you can quickly log out and log in. Or log in zarur kar lijiyega please. Ke baad if you can quickly log out and log in sir. Aapke audio mein kuch dikkat hai. And hey, we have been joined by Alka, ma'am. Jaswinder, sir, I'll come back to you. First, we'll take the opening remark from, then I'll come back to you. So we have been joined by Alka, ma'am. So Alka, ma'am, if you want to share something, your thought, what preparation your school is making for this NEP?
Well, sir, thank you for giving me a chance to be there with you people. I'm still a learner, I should say. Our school is really working on these grounds. They are training, giving the educators the various trainings to accomplish them, to work shoulder to shoulder and enable the educators to come up with various trainings. And they are even providing to trainings like the education, the examination departments, they are focusing on the teachers for all the skill developments. Also they are training, and definitely we all are working in the same direction to meet the needs and the demands of the current times. And definitely we will work out. Nothing is impossible. We must say that. Absolutely. If we can join hands, we are really going to do wonders.
Absolutely. Thank you, Alka, ma'am.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining. And I believe Munish is facing some technical glitch. So, Jaswinder sir, I would request if you can begin. Jaswinder sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Rajuji. And so, good evening, everybody. I told you, I come from the EdTech background. So, I'm going to talk upon two things. One very important thing which Dr. Pradeep Kumar talked about, that this thing, we do not know what we have started. You know, the NEP 2020 will lead to what not. But before that, you know, NEP 2020 was formulated even before the pandemic was there to come or was in the process. But what this pandemic has taught us is that we need to keep going, and for us to keep going, technology is something which is very, very important. I have been working with technology for the last 30 years, technology, especially in education. And yes, it all depends on how do you connect to the remotest part of the country? How do you deliver to the remotest part of the country? But that is all infrastructure. More than infrastructure, we need to get our teachers ready for this. So we all talk about that NEP 2020 is bringing in a lot of different things. We need to train our teachers in a lot of different things. But my first point would be that we first need to train our teachers on the use of technology. Though they have started using it out of compulsion, they have done that. Kudos to them. They've done a lot, even without any support, except a telephone support. They had nothing else during the pandemic. They've done it and they can do more. But what has to be done is we have to train our teachers to gather information from the vast pool of information that this internet provides, to gather information, to filter information, and to project it the way they need to do it. Dr. Pradeep did talk about piracy. He did talk about plagiarism. That is going to be there. But through this information, what the teachers need to do is the teachers need to gather the way they have to deliver. See, understand one thing. We have to do away with the administrative tasks that a teacher does. And that time should be used in learning more, in deriving more from whatever pool of information we have. See, understand one thing. The teachers of today are facing the learners of today and who are much faster than us. we will never be able to cope up with the pace of these learners. Because understand, we as teachers are technology migrants and the students are technology residents. They were born with a laptop, with a mobile phone in their hands. They know much more than what we can even think of doing. So what we need to do is stop being a sage on the stage and be a facilitator. That is what will work. Nowhere is it written that a teacher needs to know everything. What the teacher is supposed to do is to facilitate learning. And one important thing, a teacher learns every day. So there's nothing wrong in saying, okay, I'll get back to you tomorrow. But then we should get back tomorrow, use technology to know what the learner wants. We are preparing students for I don't know what. We are preparing for jobs we do not know which. We want to teach them, I don't know how. How do we answer these questions? These questions, everything lies is into, you know, we need to get onto that, is we need to prepare our teachers to be ready for tomorrow. So the first training is how to gather information. We need to train them on using tools, which I'm again saying that Dr. Pradeep did talk about it, that these tools have to be taught. So the major challenge is training them. But once we have trained them on using technology, then they can learn on their own. If we are saying that the world is going to learn online, why not the teachers? The only thing is the right kind of content should be curated. The right kind of content should be made available, and it should be made available on devices. Each teacher, before he or she buys a pen, needs to buy a laptop or a tablet. Understand these things. Times have changed. So technology is something very, very important. Let me give you, you know, how things can change. This may not be possible, or this may be possible even in the higher education, but flipped classroom is something that will do wonders. Let's understand what exactly, let me give you an example of a very simple example of flipped classroom, where the school need not invest into infrastructure. I'm sure most schools already have internet, and I mean, talking about six schools in the tier one and tier two cities, they have internet, they've got gadgets, they've got computers, they've got projectors, they've got flat panels, okay. But suppose if I have to teach a subject today, I go to a class, I take up a geography session, and I start delivering something on volcanoes. That's what we've been doing. So whatever I know, I download. It's a one-way teaching, which I don't know how many students would prefer. They won't. So what I should do is tell them that tomorrow I'm going to talk about volcanoes. I want each and every child to get me 10 lines on volcanoes within these parameters. What will the students do? Go home, straight go to Google and find out. Unfortunately, they will not be able to find 10 sentences. They will not find 10 sentences. They'll find 10,000 sentences. Because there's a lot of information. So the art is how to look for information in the right place, how to filter it down to get what you want. That is, again, something very, very important that we need to teach our kids. So what will happen? Each child will come the next day ready with this 10 points, and the child is supposed to present it in front of the class. So what happens? You have a class of 20, you have a class of 30, they start presenting. So the first skill that the child acquires is presentation skills, very important. Second, the child has to speak out. So second skill is communication skills. Third is collaborating, because they will collaborate with among each, themselves and come out with better 10 lines. So they are talking about presentation, we're talking about communication, we're talking about collaboration, we're talking about thinking, we're talking about peer group learning. And then what happens? They come up and put forward those 10 proper sentences. So what has happened? Everybody did their work. They did the research, so they start learning how to research. And once they've done the research, they present, and the entire class, everybody participates and learns. It is not a one person learning. It's everybody getting it. So these simple things, if put into place, if used in the classrooms, the teachers will do well, the students will do well, and there will always be a very happy and interactive classroom session. That is what will keep the students together. So they bring in information, the teacher only works as a facilitator. So that's an important thing. For all this, we need to see to it that our teachers are free to learn and get things. So ideally, you know, all administrative things should be put onto technology. Let technology handle the entire work in the school. Only teaching happens. So what will happen? Students will learn life skills in the classroom. That is something that they can't learn on internet. That is important. So this is what I say technology can do. And if we are able to come out with a tablet for every child in the country, which is not an expensive thing for India, the kind of subsidy we are giving on for other things, if this can be subsidized, I think that will do wonders. And that is how we'll be able to reach the remotest corner. We'll be able to train those 14 million teachers that we need to train, and we'll be able to train billions of students that we have. That's what, ma'am, we need to work on. Second is, let me come to my point, the area where we work as a company. We work with languages. In fact, we work with 3,000 schools, 1 million students. We've just come up with a language lab to teach Sanskrit as a language. How does that work? Why did we do that? So let me come on to this. NEP 2020 talks about that during the early foundation years, we need to, or we should, teach the students in the local language. First of all, one caveat, it is not compulsory. The schools can choose still to teach in English, but they say it is suggested. Why? During the early years, when the child is trying to acquire English as a language, if we teach them other core subjects like math and EVS in English, when they've not acquired, when they can't comprehend, how will they learn all this thing? So what happens? Learning becomes a burden with them. But if they use the local language, the child already knows that language before he comes to school. So comprehension becomes easy. They start liking it, they start loving it, and they are comfortable. So that is how you build up their core skills, foundation skills. But one very important thing, this does not mean that we should not teach them or they should not acquire English as a language. It is said that by the age of 8, a child can acquire up to 5 languages. So acquiring 3 languages is not a problem. The 3 language system is beautiful. It is also said that if a child speaks 3 or more languages, their brain works better. Imagine one sentence they put in 3 languages and still make meaning out of it. That's logic. That's important. And look at kids who speak more than 3 languages or more. They are smarter than the rest. So what can happen is we can have all 3 languages, the local or the mother tongue, foreign language, that is English, classical language, that is Sanskrit. Let that happen, and I'm sure they'll be able to do wonders. So what we have to understand as educationists, core subjects during the earlier foundation years, by the time they're good at other subjects, let those be taught in the local language, a language that the child understands. So there has been question, how will we get teachers to do that? But if a teacher is living in a certain city, he or she needs to know that local language. So it's only explanation. You can have writing in English, you can have writing in any language, but explanation, understanding of concepts, if that is done in local languages, it will work wonders. So that's what we are talking about. That's what NEP 2020 talks about. And that's exactly what we mean by that. So overall, if we do this, things will be very, very simple. And life will be simple for these students. They will never cry when they have to go to school. I'll tell you, one earlier presenter had said that there was a small child in a preschool. That little child wanted to go to the washroom. And in that school, it was compulsory to speak in English. The child could not frame a sentence. And by the time he framed the sentence, wo ho gaya tha. Imagine that poor child couldn't say anything. Hindi mein bolna tha, ma'am, mujhe jana hai. So this is something important. We need to understand that we should give them time to acquire a language. If you give them time, they will love it. If you force it on them, they will hate it. So language, very properly put up. I say, I give full points to NEP that when they talk about this. Plus what is happening is we are valuing our own languages. India has so many languages. We should understand different languages. When you acquire a certain language, you also understand the culture and heritage of that particular region of the country. So that's what I would put up. Great things put up. Over to you, Rajuji. I conclude my part from here.
Thank you, Jaswinder sir, for highlighting these two important areas, technology and language. And we all agree with you, sir. We need to adopt technology. We need to, become friendly with all, aspects of technology. We have to use it. We must embrace it. you also talked about, in fact, a lot of people are regularly asking questions, you know, from the language part. There are people who are confused with this three language formula or mother tongue implication. We would be presenting these questions to you. And we have Alka ma'am, who's a English faculty with DPS Gwalior. So I'm sure Alka ma'am would be sharing some kind of perspective. She would be representing the English educators during the question part. So big thanks once again, Pradeep sir, Sandeep sir, Jaswinder sir, you know, for sharing your perspective and thoughts. With this, we come to the last part of the session, which is the question part. So I would request all our key speakers, you know, if I may present these questions to you. So let's take the first question, which Alka ma'am, you know, shared during the registration process. I'm sharing the question in the chat box. So Pradeep sir, I would request if you may take on this question, the question in the chat box.
Yes, please.
So Alka Chaturvedi ma'am, English PGP with Delhi Public School, Gwalior. She has asked this question: how and what will be the work of National Mission for Mentoring in the coming years?
Yes, both at the school level and higher education level, the mentoring panel will be there. In AICT, they call it the Mark Daksha. So those things are required because everybody is not well versed with the outcome-based education and new education policy. The earlier speaker was talking about the flipped class. So even many faculty members are not able to understand what is the meaning of flipped class. So we need the mentors. We need somebody who has experimented all these outcome-based education and has personally gone through the delivery and assessment and outcome. You know, there are four components in outcome-based education. One is the designing of curriculum. That is the most important part. How will we be able to design a curriculum based on the outcomes? The second is the delivery. What teaching learning pedagogy will adopt? And third is the assessment. And the fourth is finally, where is my final product has gone as per my program outcome? What we have seen in the last 1 year now, everybody has adopted the delivery mechanism. Students and faculty members, they have used MS Team, Zoom, and all channels which are available, and the delivery is there. But the assessment is not there. We have proctored exam. We can say the proctored online examination is there, but everybody knows how the examinations are conducted in higher education, especially, and how these have been evaluated. So we are lacking that part. So the question, I'm coming back to the question. The question is very clear. Mentoring is required. We need many, many mentors at all levels. Only they will discuss with the faculty members. So first we need to train the faculty member, and then faculty members need to train the students and parents. Only then the real sense of this new education policy will be in place.
Right. Thank you, sir. I'll come back to you. Now, I see Shivastava sir has joined us. Shivastava sir, can we have your perspective on national education policy? And then we'll continue this question part. Shivastava sir. So you are on mute. Sir, you are on mute, sir. Munish sir.
Sorry. Now I am audible?
Yes, absolutely, sir. You're audible. Your great voice is coming to all of us. And big thanks for joining us. We know that you had your practical exam today at your school. So big thanks. Yes, sir. Manish, sir. Over to you.
It was a big hectic schedule because during this pandemic time, it becomes very difficult to conduct the examination. Keeping all the COVID protocols intact, it becomes very tough. First of all, I would like to, you can say sorry that because of this technical glitch, I was not being able to take the full benefit of this webinar. As I was listening to Mr. Sandeep Kumar Singh, and it was very informative. And it was close to the main, you can say, whatever the main theme. So at present, what I can say, I will just want to add up to that discussion and whatever the points were discussed by Mr. Sandeep Kumar Singh Ji, that the vision of this policy, that NAP 2020, has opened up a lot of, you can say, avenues in the education sector. And the education system, the problem is coming in front of the administrator, because our education system was more oriented, marks oriented. The parents are marks oriented, the teachers are marks oriented, students are marks oriented. Instead of the need, which was as it was focused or emphasized in the NEP 2020, the need to be, we are supposed to be focusing on the skill development. And that is what is being addressed by the NEP 2020 more precisely. Then we should focus on more skill development of the children rather than giving them the rote learning, or you can say mugging up all the lessons or all the questions, rather than focusing on the development of their skills which they have. So what I suggest is that this education system, I just want to add, because already everything was covered, and I was fortunate enough to be a part of this. So I just want to add up this thing that education system rooted in Indian ethos that contributes directly to transforming India. That is, more precisely, we say Bharat sustainably into an equitable and vibrant knowledge society by providing high quality education to all, and thereby making India a global knowledge superpower. Secondly, the curriculum and pedagogy of an institution must develop a deep sense of respect towards the fundamental duties and constitutional values, bonding with one's country, and conscious awareness of one's roles and responsibilities in changing world. To instill a deep-rooted pride in being Indian, not only in thought, but also in spirit, intellect, and deed, as well as to develop knowledge, skill, values, disposition that support responsible commitment to human rights, sustainable development, and living and global well-being, thereby reflecting a truly global citizen. So we would like to open up the, you can say, our regional boundaries to a global boundaries now. And we are focusing, we are trying our level best that the student should not limit to some localized thing. They should be on the global platform. They are open, keeping their local values intact, because we don't have to go away, as what the government initiative is local is vocal. So we have to keep that in consideration. So we just want to make this local as a global thing, so that their talent, their skills are nurtured up to that, precisely up to that level. So we are focusing on, we would like to having, be like, excuse me, we are keeping our finger crossed for maximum, you can say, that how the things are going to take a shape in the coming years. And we just say that if the our mentors or our educators are going to take up this thing in good stride, then definitely this is going to be a boon for this education sector, as well as to develop a manpower of 21st century, that what is the need, and that is what being addressed by this NEP. So already the things were discussed. I have prepared the topic for this webinar, the most important, you can say, issue of procrastination. And as the time is not going to permit me, because already it is going to be, you can say, very limited time. So I just cover up a certain point of that particular thing, that there are most of us, please I request that I forgot to wish everyone, those who are involved over here. Good evening to one and all. As I was rushing to my topic, so please forgive me for this thing. I really appreciate and I really pass my or convey my thanks to the organizers that they have given me this opportunity to be a part of this intellect webinar. And we are addressing a very important issue. So I just bind up, I will just take two or three minutes for covering up this very important issue, because this is what is going to be a main address to this implementation of this NEP 2020. Because already we procrastinated in implementing, and in whole, we are taking up this thing that by 2030, we are going to implement the whole complete NEP by all means in all the schools. So I just thought of discussing some important point of regarding this procrastination. So I just start up with this, and even I will share up so that you can have it for the future reference. Most of us procrastinate, or correction, I will say ki all of us procrastinate. I even procrastinated in writing or in addressing this thing to you all. We have been all there at some point. Here are 5 tips I am going to share it with you to avoid procrastination, to break out of paralysis and start producing at your peak. This is what my objective is. I hope that I am going to cover up all this thing in during the due course of time. So reduce the number of decisions. My first point, reduce the number of decisions you need to take throughout the day. So I just elaborate it. Every decision we make has an energy consequence. If you wake up in the morning and you need to ask yourself, what do I need to do today? Well, you are about to procrastinate the shit out of today. If you approach each new day without having given thought to what you wanted to look like ahead of time, then you will waste a large portion of your energy thinking about what to do and what not to do. So should I hit the gym today or go tomorrow? Should I say yes to lunch with whatever thing, whatever the cuisine you have set for? Or should I do a quick lunch solo so I can get back to the office and finish up this presentation or webinar? Should I wear this or wear that? Eat this or eat that? Reply no or later. We are asking ourselves questions like this all day long. Problem is, questions compel us to respond with answer, which compel us to make decision. This drain you of your self-control and makes you tired, which leads to you procrastinating on whatever matters most of your life. So this is the problem which we all are facing. Now, I am just giving you a tip which I have taken out for avoiding procrastination is to reduce the number of decisions you need to make during a given day by making those decisions ahead of time and of creating habits around certain areas of your life to boost your effectiveness and prevent you from draining your energy by thinking about whether to do them or not. Some example, decide in advance exactly which day of the week you will exercise instead of deciding the day off. Pick out your clothes the night before rather than the morning of. The most important thing that needs to get done tomorrow and schedule time to do it. These are just a few simple examples, but it is usually the simple thing that matters most. What are some examples you can think of to reduce the number of decisions you make in your life? Doing this will free up the energy you will need in order to stay focused on doing the big plus meaningful stuff rather than procrastinating on it by doing the little plus meaningful stuff. Second point, I will just wind up. Phenotype before it starts. This typic of where tip one leads off. The best decision you can make towards avoid procrastination is to plan your days in advance. Rather than frantically figuring out what you will do on any given day, a better way to approach your day would be to take a few minutes at the end of each day to quickly map out the following day. For example, every night before bed, I write down reviews my plans for the next day, which includes my one big thing, that is OBT, that needs to get done that day. This could be a big task, a goal, or a project I need to make progress on. My no matter what, NMWs, these are my non-negotiable daily habits, exercise, my nature, walk daily, meditation, reading 30 minutes minimum, mastery related work, and time spent with the people I love. Whatever else needs to be done the following day, this way my most important goals and projects are given ample time to be crushed and to not be procrastinated on. Third, the nothing alternative. The nothing alternative is a tip for avoiding procrastination that was coined by an inflation crime fiction novelist named Raymond Chandler. He used it as a way to avoid procrastinating on his daily writing. Chandler had difficulty sitting down at the keyboard and cranking out a predetermined word count every day, like some successful writers. So he developed another method for overcoming procrastination and getting himself to do the work. He would set aside 4 hours every morning and give himself an ultimatum, write or do nothing at all. And Chandler advises writers and presumably people of all professions who suffer from procrastination to do the same. He doesn't have to write, says Chandler, and if he doesn't feel like it, he shouldn't try. He can look out of the window or stand on his head or write on the floor, but he is not to do any other positive thing, not read, write letters, glance at a magazine, or write checks, write or nothing. That was Chandler's philosophy, and for him, it worked. The rules are pretty straightforward. A rule, you don't have to write or work on whatever you need to work on. Secondly, but you can't do anything else. With these two options in mind, at some point, you are gonna start working even. This is simply something which is need to be taken care of. And I like that many times situations and everything, you can say, the atmosphere or the conditions sometimes are not conducive for us to take a decision instantly. Instead, we procrastinate. It becomes a necessity. So sometimes it is going to be somewhat okay, but usually procrastination is a habit which need not to be practiced. So I would request that this is what my humble submission is, and this is my tips how you can come up with your things all together. So thank you for giving me this opportunity, and I would like to convey my regards to each and everyone present over here. And if any question, anything, you just please.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you, Manish sir, for your wonderful thoughts. In the first part, you talked about...
is it audible?
So, thank you, Manish sir, for sharing the valuable thoughts. In the first part, you talked about the essence of national education policy, and you shared your assessment that NEP is in a strong attempt to identify, recognize, and empower Indian values. And the second part, explain why and how we can avoid the procrastination. You explained those things. And eventually, if I connect that with the NEP, how we should, and we can implement the education policy in the right way. So big thanks, sir. We were, we were in the part of the question part. So, we presented one question to Pradeep sir. Now, second question, I would request Pradeep sir, if I may present to you. This is a very interesting question. I'm just posting the question in the chat box. This has been asked by Mr. Devesh Sharma. He's a PGT with Delhi Public School, Mathura. Devesh has asked, what will be the new role of principal, in the school post NEP implementation? So, Sandeep sir, do you see any change in the role?
Yeah. I can understand. Actually, the role of the principal, what I think is that it will be more of the technology based again in the NEP. If we could again recollect our 20, 25 years back, then we used to have a small phone in our hands. And now we are on the webinars. So the role of the principal in the NEP will be it should be, principal should himself or herself should be more of the technology based. And he or she should train the teachers also and motivate also their staff members that they should also be of the technology based. Or what I could again recollect that about 4 or 5 years back, I used to say to my kids also, not to use the mobile and not to use the laptop for a longer time. But now the trend has changed. Now I tell my kids to use the mobile, to use the laptop. And in fact, the entire setup is being done by my kids only at my house. So the role of the principal will be that he or she should be more technology minded and motivate the staff to be more of that kind also. I think this is my answer to Mr. Devesh.
Right, sir. Please. Thank you. Thank you, Sandeep, sir. Yeah. We also noticed that your son, who's working with Infosys, also joined us in the first part of the session. Yes, Manish, sir. Yes, Manish, sir. Ye toh aapse bhi main puchunga.
Manish, sir, bol sakte, please.
I just want to add up this thing that administrator has an example. So administrator role is going to be very important because the administrator has to deal up with the stuff, those who are not technology savvy. So the administrator has to set an example. Otherwise, the concept of this NEP is going to be fail in all terms. So it is to be very, very important. First, whatever the PD session the administrator has to go through, they should go and they should update themselves up to the maximum so that they can train their staff. As what is addressed by the Sir Sandeep Kumar Singh Ji.
Yeah.
That earlier the administrator was not at all technology.
Yeah.
Now they have up, and we are coming on this webinar and sharing our things. That's a really a one. Are you?